If you work with Lightroom, I'm sure you've faced this problem. You're using your mouse for everything, which feels really slow. And when you try to use shortcuts on your keyboard, they make no sense or require you to press multiple keys. And you have to keep moving your right hand back and forth from the mouse constantly. What if I told you you could turn your keyboard into a custom macro pad where everything that you need is one key press away, exactly where it makes sense for you and your workflow? Hello everyone! So, for example, in Lightroom, the arrows are ideal for navigating through pictures. But the moment I want to edit something, I need to move my hand back to the mouse. It would be super great if I could have the arrow keys on my left hand, let's say on S and F, to move through my gallery. Or what if instead of pressing Shift-Command-C to copy a picture setting and then pressing Shift-Command-V to paste them, you could just press C and then V. It sounds like a dream, right? And that's precisely what you can do with a programmable keyboard. Until recently, programmability was a feature that was mostly exclusive to ergonomic keyboards. But nowadays, many mechanical keyboards that cost around $100 are programmable too, like multiple Keychron models or the popular Newfi 75. So, to help us explore all the possibilities, I've asked Mikkel, our head of marketing, to share with us how he has transformed his keyboard into a Lightroom macro pad.
Hello there. The first thing that I need to do is press the button that takes me to Lightroom mode. As you can see, there are no keys assigned on the right side, so I really don't need that. That way, I can have more space for my mouse. Let me show you how I navigate and categorize my images. I have assigned the arrow keys to S and F so I can move back and forth my gallery. I also have assigned the numbers to the number row so I can do 1 star, 2 stars, 3 stars, 4 stars, 5 stars, and if I want also 0 stars, which usually is on the right side of the keyboard and is pretty uncomfortable to remove stars from images. Another way that you can categorize images is with flags. Here on the X, if I double tap, I will flag an image. If I hold it, I will remove the flag, and let's find an image that I don't like. So for example, these two images, they're very similar, and this one, I don't like the crop so much. So I will press X and it will be set as rejected. And talking about cropping, let's crop this image, which I don't like that much how it's framed. Okay, so I press R like you would do normally on Lightroom, and then you just resize the image like do, and press Enter. But let's say I don't like this crop so much. I can reset the crop easily by pressing crop and then holding the same key, which will do Alt Command R that resets the crop. Another thing that I have on this same key is Command Bracket, which lets me rotate the image if I double tap. Of course, I don't want it like that. So if I continue double tapping, I can continue rotating the image and it will be back to normal. So let's put again the crop that I like. And I can show you a little neat feature. Imagine that you have an image that is 2/3, you know, 3x2, and you don't really like that composition, or you wanna really do a free cropping. With A, I can activate and deactivate the lock for the original ratio. So now if I deactivate it with A, I can do my free cropping. And if I wanna lock it again, I can just press A again, and now it will be resized with the original ratio. Finally, I would like to show you another cool little thing that I have in my A key. If I'm in crop mode, and let's say I want my image now vertical instead of horizontal, if I hold the A, it will flip the aspect ratio. And also in this key, if I double tap, I will rotate the image counterclockwise. So let's move now to a tool that many of us use a lot, which is the remove tool. Let me find an image where I want to remove an object. This one, for example, let's say I want to remove the bottom keyboard and I want to keep just the top part of the keyboard. If I press Q, I will access the remove tool. But if I hold Q, I can activate and deactivate the generative AI, which is pretty useful when you don't want to use it. And if I double tap, the select tool will be object aware or not. So I will toggle between the both of them. Okay, let's put generative AI on and object aware on too, and select this object here, and now I press apply or just enter and it will be generated. As you can see, the remove tool didn't do a great job, but you can see how this is useful. Another thing that is useful, especially when you're using things like this remove tool, is to zoom in and out of your image. So I have here these two buttons, the T and the G, which zoom in and zoom out. And if you don't like the zoom that you have, you press spacebar and it goes back. So far we've covered the crop menu and the remove menu. But if you want to access the red eye menu, there is no shortcut for that. You can either go here to the toolbar and select it, or you have to go to the menu and go to Tools, Red Eye, which is not, both of them require you to use the mouse. But with a macro, you can record how you would access the menu bar with your keyboard. I think in Mac is you have to press Shift F2, then press T, and then drop down until you find that menu. But I have recorded that on my letter B. So if I press B, boom. Here, I have red eye. Of course, in this image, there is no eyes, but because I don't need it, but it's a cool way to access this feature. Let me show you now all the settings that I have to easily edit an image. So I'm gonna just go and edit an image and show you how all my shortcuts work. So for example, let's find an image that's not edited, like this one. To start, I'm gonna copy the setting from another image. So for example, I like the settings of this image. I will press C, which will copy the settings. Usually in Lightroom, this is Shift Command C, and then I press Enter, so I copy them, and then I press V, which will paste them. Usually in Lightroom, this is Shift Command V, which is much more uncomfortable. Okay, so here are the settings, but I don't really like how light the background is compared to the keyboard. The keyboard maybe is a little bit dark, so let's start by making the keyboard a little bit brighter. I can, with my Tab and my caps lock, I have assigned those to comma and period, which will let me navigate through the settings. You can see here that I'm navigated through the temperature, the tint, the exposure, the contrast. So let's go to exposure. And I can move my exposure up and down with my E and D letters, because I have assigned plus to E and minus to D, and that goes up exposure and down exposure. So I would like something like that. But now, as I said, the background is a little bit too bright. I don't like it. So to fix that, I need a mask. To activate the mask, I have assigned Shift W to hold on my W key. If I press hold here, then my mask is activated, and I will now select the background, create new mask, and select background. Now the background is selected, and I can edit the macro background, and I'm going to put exposure down. And if I scroll down, I think I'm going to do some dehaze too. So dehaze. Okay. Much better now, right? With the masking done, maybe now I want to do white balance, which I also have assigned to my W, but just on tap. So if I press W, I will have here my eyedrop, and press that, and there you go. My white balance has been done. Another thing that's pretty useful when editing an image is being able to easily compare your image to the unedited version. To toggle between before and after on an image in Lightroom, that's backlash, which is usually on the right hand of the keyboard, pretty uncomfortable, but I have that assigned to my thumb key. If I tap it, you can see the before, tap it, you can see the after. And if I hold it, I can activate soft proof, which puts the background in white in case you want to see if your image is too bright or too dark. If I hold it again, it will go back to my normal background. And that's basically when I'm done with Lightroom. I can bring my other half of the keyboard back, press the normal mode key, and go back to my normal keyboard. Of course, this is just how I've designed my Lightroom macro pad to suit my workflow. Thanks to the software included with a programmable keyboard, you can easily customize it to your liking. I'll let Dominique show you how you can configure yours.
Hello again! So, as we mentioned in the beginning, to turn your keyboard into a Lightroom macro pad, you're gonna need a programmable keyboard. For this example, we'll use the Digma Race 2. First, open the software, which for the Digma keyboards, it's Base Core. Second, create a new layer, and let's call it Lightroom. Add a key to access the new layer, lock 4, and then add a key to go back to the base layer, which is your layer 1, so lock 1. Now let's customize the new layer. You can start easily by remapping keys. For example, let's add the arrow keys and the plus and minus functions. Easy. Let's add the rest of the normal keys. Then you can add shortcuts. Just select the key and add your desired modifiers. Let's do C plus Command plus Shift, which is copy settings on a Mac. Now let's move to macros, which are great for things that don't have shortcuts. With our software, you can create them by adding text, recording them, or manually adding the keystrokes one by one. All right, so here you can see the macro that Mikkel used to create red eye mode. Control F2 to access the menu, T to move to tools, and then 3 down, and then you have enter. Once you have created a macro, add them to wherever you want on your macro pad. Finally, let's see how you can create cool keys that activate a different function if you tap, hold, or double tap them. We call them super keys. Go to the super keys menu and create as many as you need. Super keys can be normal keys, shortcuts, mouse keys, or even macros. Once you have created them, assign them to where you want them on your macro pad. Awesome, the layout of the macro pad is ready, but it looks a little bit dull. Let's add some color. So for that, you need to head to the color editor and assign the colors to the keys as you like. You can create your own palette for your macro board, but we always recommend that the colors have some kind of meaning to the function, like green for the plus symbol and red for the minus symbol. This visual aid will help you learn the layout. All right, so press save one last time and boom! Your Lightroom macro pad is ready.
Please bear in mind that not all programmable keyboards have all these functionalities that Dominique just showed you.
For example, the cheapest ones like the Keychron or Nufi 75 don't have super keys, also known as tap dance, or per key RGB, and the number of custom macros you can have is limited.
Other more advanced keyboards, such as the Moonlander, the Voyager, or the Glove 80, have different limitations. For example, the Moonlander and the Voyager have macros limited to 5 key presses.
The Glove 80 software, on the other hand, requires custom code to configure per key RGB.
One last important benefit of split ergonomic keyboards as MacroPads is that you can use just one half of the keyboard to leave more room for your mouse, trackpad, or drawing tablet. Pretty handy.
If you had a custom keyboard like this, how would you customize it? And let us know in the comments what app you want us to do next. If you use Notion or DaVinci, we've made similar videos. Just check them out here. Bye! Bye.